Good morning and thank you all for joining. My name is Caitlin. I'll be the moderator for today. We are joined by Gigya's Senior Vice President of Marketing, Jason Rose, for today's webinar, Customer Identity and Access Management Market Overview. We're glad to have you. A few housekeeping items before we begin. Everyone's audio lines have been muted for the duration of the call, but we're taking questions at the end. To ask a question, simply enter it into the Q&A section of the console. We are recording the webinar and we'll be sending it out in the next coming days. With that, I'll hand it over to Jason. He'll get us started. Jason?
Great. Well, thank you very much, Caitlin, and welcome everybody to the webinar today. Obviously, customer identity and access management really is, I'll call it a trending topic, to use the Twitter vernacular. The market really has been forming. I've been on board with Gigya now for about a little over a year and a half. And in that time, I think we've seen a strong move away from, kind of this nascent kind of forming entity, customer identity and access management, where does it fit, to really a more kind of well-defined market and scope. And we've actually seen a whole lot of activity over the past, I'll call it really 9 months, I'd say, in terms of the analysts who always lag a little bit behind customers, really beginning to write more about the space. And I think the first example of that was Gartner published a document called a Critical Capabilities Report for their Identity and Access Management as a Service, or IDAS, market category. And within that report, Gartner included a B2C, a business-to-consumer use case. And I think this was really, if I had to think about it, the very first report that really took an evaluation of all the vendors that offer a customer-related identity and access management solution. But this was, I'll call it a small portion of a bigger report. So it was a good step in the right direction. I think it gave people in customer identity a place to go to and look at a stack ranking of vendors and some of the different capabilities they should look for. But again, it was one of three different use cases in the report, so it wasn't fully comprehensive. Some of you may be familiar with a company called Kuppinger Cole. So Kuppinger Cole is a specialist analyst firm based out of Germany. And they actually have an evaluation framework called the Leadership Compass. And back in October of 2016, they actually published the first Leadership Compass on customer identity and access management. And this was a bit of a different story. This was a full 54-page write-up and document on customer identity and access management, key considerations, differences between IAM and CIAM, and then key considerations and capabilities for a number of different vendors in the space. So I would say, this was the first fully dedicated report to the customer identity and access management space in a comprehensive fashion that really compared vendors side by side. I think it was a really great piece of research. As you can see by the cover page I'm showing here on the slide, they actually just refreshed this back in June. So this is the second actual iteration of this report, and I think it contains a lot of really solid kind of thoughts, things to consider, best practices, and a number of different kind of key points, vendor by vendor, to really think about across four different categories: overall market leadership, product leadership, market awareness, and really kind of delving into each one of those in detail, and then even providing a set of crosstabs amongst those four different categories. So a really solid evaluation, but from, I would call it, a smaller firm that many people hadn't necessarily heard of. And then finally, and really kind of something that we'll deep dive a little bit on in today's webinar, Forrester, just back in June 15th, published the Forrester Way for Customer Identity and Access Management. And for those of you that do software evaluations, who kind of follow the Gartners and the Forresters of the world, you know that Gartner has a framework called the Magic Quadrant, where they plot things out. out and kind of rate vendors across two axes, ability to execute and their product offering. Well, Forrester, of course, is the other major firm that does these evaluations, and the Forrester Wave is their premier way of kind of describing a market and then evaluating market participants. So we were extremely excited to see a major analyst firm like Forrester really kind of take up the mantle and publish a new report that really delved into customer identity and access management. Now, let's go into a little bit of the why. Why is there so much buzz around customer identity right now? Why are these firms publishing? And as I mentioned, the firms, the analysts are kind of a bellwether. They lag a little bit behind where the customers and where the market is because they tend to go where the demand is based on the inquiries they're getting, the questions they're getting from customers. So let's talk a little bit about customer identity and access management and why it's getting this attention and buzz. The one thing I will say before I leave this slide is if you go to www.gigya.com and you scroll down, you can actually download all three of these reports for free from gigya.com right now if you're so inclined and get all of the great detail, thought, and considerations around customer identity that these three reports really represent. And in a few minutes, I'm going to dive into the Forrester Wave and give you some insights and thoughts around that particular evaluative framework. But really, I think the analysts are sitting up and paying attention to customer identity for these three big reasons. One, as we think about digital teams and customer acquisition, really that registration and login experience is a huge point of friction and potential barrier to entry for customers to identify themselves and start to build that trusted digital relationship with an organization. So anything you can do to reduce the challenges of signing up, either creating an account or signing up for a newsletter or having a customer provide an email address or cell phone number to get alerts, is going to increase your conversion rate, and the lifetime value of one of those customers is quite high and allows you to now take a consent-based approach to personalization and customization, making sure that you can meet that person's needs wherever they may come and interact with your site across not only the web channel, but across apps, mobile, tablet devices and other channels that that customer might choose to interact with your brand. And customer identity can really provide the glue to hold all of that together. Now, I mentioned that kind of consent-based approach to personalization and customization, and that's where this tie-in to privacy and compliance really comes in. So now we're dealing with customers that have provided personal information. They've put their hand up and said, I want you as a brand to know me better. And as a good steward and of that information, really making sure that you're complying things like with things like the General Data Protection Regulation, which is being phased in over the next 10 months in Europe, comes into effect at the end of May. There's a number of different data localization requirements, whether that be the Russian Federation's personal data protection legislation or the Chinese cybersecurity law, where those countries require their citizens' data to be stored within those geographies. So really important that you're paying attention to where, not only what data is being stored, but also where it's being stored. And then finally, making sure that you have all of the appropriate opt-ins, consent, which version of terms of service were agreed to by that customer. So you can make sure that if an audit were to occur, you've got all of the right information stored in a way that can provide those auditors with clarity of what you're doing. And then finally, of course, since we're dealing with customer data, this is some of the information that you really need to protect and make sure you're storing securely. And Gigya right now is actually storing over 1.3 billion identities on behalf of our over 700 customers in a very secure way, ensuring we have the right access, and even using that corpus of information to further protect accounts and make sure that we're using the value of that 1.3 billion person community to protect all of the identities within our identity cloud. So let's delve into these in a little bit of detail. And let's think about, you know, how customer identity enables customer experience. And I think, you know, if we think about the digital world, I think sometimes it feels like almost like a game of chutes and ladders, right? You kind of take two steps forward. A company does a really good job of, you know, kind of that sign-up process. I'm really interested in what you have to offer. But then instead of pushing me after I've purchased a pair of shoes, instead of pushing me coupons or a two-for-one offer on my next pair of shoes, those shoes haunt me and follow me around the internet, even though I've already purchased them. So there's a potential to really alienate customers there. Again, by having a customer identity and access management solution, you can begin to see where is that customer in the life cycle. Are they at the consideration phase? They're doing some research. They're really trying to understand your product offerings. Or are they already a customer and you should be pushing them offers and promotions, right? So many companies will take two steps forward in terms of getting that first-party consent-based information and then one step back by improperly targeting that user with the wrong offer. So there's a lot of potential for ups and downs. And we see this across a number of different industries. So, you know, again, just think of that about the personalization that can happen when you have a positive interaction. I've bought a really nice, shirt and pants, and maybe I want the belt or some other accessories to go along with that. But guess what? Instead, I'm being stalked by that shirt and pair of pants across the internet, even though I've already purchased it. In the health and wellness category, again, making sure that you understand that person's interest, that you understand what that person wants to be followed by, how your company can help them achieve their health goals, rather than spamming them with irrelevant content or newsletters that really don't align into what they're kind of trying to provide. And then finally, in media and entertainment, obviously, a lot of these, they're called over-the-top experiences. So if you think about what HBO has done with HBO Now and HBO Go, kind of going to that online experience where, you know, I log in from my PC, I maybe start watching Game of Thrones there, I move over to my iPhone to watch it during my commute, and then in the evening, I want to watch it on my Apple TV on the big screen. Well, now, all of those interactions are remembered so that we can provide a consistent experience across all those devices, as opposed to having to log in and figure out, fast forward through those movies and figure out where I was supposed to be. So really being able to provide that cross-channel, cross-device experience and make sure that customers are being served in the best possible way. Now, this also kind of brings into kind of the thought process, this idea of building consumer trust, right? I think consumers very much want that personalization, but they want to know how, when, and why you're building your data to actually provide that personal data. And like the lady on the slide is holding here, just stop inferring and ask. You can ask me what I'm interested in, but if you do ask me, make sure you use those preferences to serve me. And what we're seeing is about two-thirds of customers don't trust brands with their personal information. So again, I think this is a bit of a scathing indictment of marketing practices today in terms of really, I think customers are wary of giving information and then having that quote-unquote used against them in their marketing practices or potentially sold and bundled off to other vendors where they're going to get offers they don't want. So customers are expressing a great deal of concern. However, this is the very data that allows those personalized omni-channel experiences, which I think every customer is hoping for. Now, the interesting thing is when in terms of controlling this information, customers really do take accountability for their own information, and we can see this with over 63% of individuals really do feel that they should be responsible for protecting their information versus brands or government. So I think this is a really interesting point, and what we're seeing in the data is that consumers really, if given the opportunity, will take action and use that data. So what we've seen is The actions consumers take after a breach certainly range from changing a password, but I think actually the one at the top here, where 18% have actually closed an account, is actually quite scathing. If you think about this, if you have a data breach, to lose almost 20%, one in five of your customers, to have them shut down their account is pretty, pretty serious stuff. So you want to make sure that you're empowering those customers and that you're, taking that data protection and data privacy quite seriously. Now, if you think about it, I mentioned GDPR a little bit earlier, and I think this is just one example of a privacy regulation that's coming into effect. Of course, it's affecting the entire EU and Britain, so again, a huge impact. But really, the impetus behind GDPR is to really put the customer in control of their data, right? To empower the customer. You can see these individual rights that are granted under GDPR. And these really require a fundamental rethinking of how you're interacting with the customer, how you're really allowing them to self-serve to see what information you have about that person. That ability for that person to update or even erase that information, removing the information, restrict how you use that data, and then even be able to download that information and bring it to another provider. So you think about, the consumers want control, and GDPR is really empowering those customers with control of their information. And obviously, customer identity and access management plays a key role in making that happen. And of course, if you think about the rest of the world, obviously there's a big focus in Europe right now, but really strong regulations coming in on a global scale as well. Now, of course, all of this sounds really really great, and obviously customer identity plays a key role in fulfilling this, but don't I already have a digital stack today, a digital marketing stack? Why can't I just do this using, my Adobe, my Sitecore, my CRM system in Salesforce, my Marketo or MailChimp or SendGrid for email marketing? Well, if you think about all of the systems I've just mentioned, usually there's like a many-to-many relationship in terms of information across these. Now, all of those things I just mentioned might be relevant to a single brand. But if you think about, many of you are probably operating in a multi-brand environment where maybe you have five different geographies around the world and 30 to 300 different brands within each one of those geographies. And you think about the interactions across all of these systems, becomes quite complicated. So how do you get that definitive view of the customer when all that customer information is spread across these multiple systems? And we've been doing work with, as I mentioned, over 700 different customers, and literally every time we go in, we find customers that have anywhere between 20 to, I think, as high as 600 different systems that contain customer data. And this really causes an issue in terms of getting all this information into a single unified view. And this is where customer identity really becomes core to that digital stack. So really providing that front-end interaction across the customer journey from anonymous to full sign-on, and then sign-on even across your web properties with single sign-on so that you can track from your brand property into your loyalty program, and frankly, into the next brand in your customer lifecycle. Really, once you have that information, having that centralized repository that, as I mentioned, allows you to choose which geography information is stored in, particularly for Europe, Australia, Russia, and China, who all have data localization requirements that require you to store citizen data within those countries if you are collecting information from those citizens. Doing that in a consistent way that can then be shared and audited, and then of course feeding back all of that information in a consistent format back into all of the systems that are interacting with that customer. And this is really how customer identity ties together the full digital stack. Make everything from that front-end interaction with the customer across all of the different channels you're interacting with, storing it in a privacy-safe way that allows the customer to self-serve and update information, and then being able to push that information into all of the relevant systems where those interactions are happening, so you have that one consistent view of the customer across all of these different touch points. And this is, you know, really now where we start to look at, okay, well, these are the major trends that have driven the interest from the analyst community, real value that customers are seeing and getting out of their customer identity and access management platforms. So now let's turn our attention and see, you know, if this is the market and this is the functionality that customers are receiving value out of, let's take a moment now and let's dive into that Forrester Wave report and see what Forrester's commentary on the overall market is. So as I mentioned, the Forrester Wave for customer identity and access management was published in Q2, which for some of us might feel like a lifetime ago, but really was only 3 weeks ago. So really, this was published back in mid-June. And I think if you think about the real overarching theme for what Forrester was putting together here is really this concept that customer identity and access management enables personal, trusted digital experiences. And this is literally one of the first highlights, one of the first sets of commentary from Forrester. And you can see here the points, and I'll take each one in order, in terms of how customer identity actually enables those trusted digital experiences. The first is really, as I mentioned, removing friction and streamlining that customer acquisition and registration process. And that really moves from technologies that are very much the here and now, so things like social login and being able to bring your own identity into the sign-up experience, so you don't have to create new passwords, new usernames, and kind of remember all that as part of the process. You can just use Facebook, Google, Twitter, LinkedIn, single click, provide the permissions, and then move in. So really reducing friction in that process, but also doing things like passwordless authentication. So maybe you just want a one-time PIN via mobile device or email to set up that account. Or maybe you want to take advantage of biometrics, so taking advantage of, say, Touch ID or on the iPhone, or being able to use the fingerprint scanner on your Android devices and allowing people to authenticate that way. So again, customer identity and access management really enables you to have a platform that really allows you to plug and play all these modern registration processes to help reduce friction and hopefully increase your overall conversion rates. Now, once that user is signed up in your system, and if you kind of think back to the slide I showed with all of those kind of red lines and connection points between your marketing stack, really the next step in customer identity is really being able to manage all of the consent and all of the preferences that have been collected from that customer across all of those different channels, and doing that in a centralized way that allows you to meet the needs of global privacy requirements. So again, now you've got one place to store that data and share back with auditors or your stakeholders exactly what information has been collected, where it's come from, what was the version of terms of service that was agreed to, and make sure that you've got the appropriate consent to then communicate with that customer electronically. Again, the other component here is to be able to provide that user-centric or self-service ability for preference management. So within the Gigya platform, we have something called progressive profiling, where over time you can get to know that customer. You can ask maybe one or two questions up front. On the second login, ask one or two more to build up this kind of body of knowledge around that user's preferences, how they want to interact with you, what they'd like to see, but then being able to manage that in that centralized platform so that when the email marketing system tries to send an email, some of those personalizations can be added into that email. Or the next time they visit the website, maybe you're feeding some of that data up into your ad serving technology so you could know that Jason is someone that's interested in skiing and has a size 11 foot, so we can start pushing the right socks, the right ski boots, the right equipment out to that out to me as a customer versus the kind of standard random offer. And then really this customer identity can also become the central repository for all information about that customer across all channels. So if you think about the way Gigya builds platforms, it's not only, builds profiles, it's not only about the information the customers kind of entered into the system, it's also things like IP address, device ID, behavioral data that can be stored along with that profile. So we can start to say, okay, Jason signed up We know he's come in through a MacBook using Chrome. We know he's come in through an iPhone device, and we know he's come in through an iPad, and start to store all of that as part of the customer profile. So regardless of which way I choose to interact with your brand, I have the same great customer experience. My preferences carry through. And frankly, that's why if we look at that 1.3 billion identities Gigya stores today, we have over 4.8 billion devices stored on behalf of those identities, right? So in my example, Jason would have four different devices stored against my profile, and again, enabling that kind of cross-device, cross-channel visibility into how we can best serve Jason as a customer. And then finally, of course, this information is extremely rich from a demographic profiling and summary perspective. So really being able to provide great analytics and reporting around the number of registrations per second, drop-off rates, and then once the customer is signed up, being able to look into, you know, what is the demographics of my audience? What are the highest interests? What are they looking at overall? And really being able to provide reporting and insights back to your marketing team to really allow them to personalize and understand their audience better so they can do a better job of going out and acquiring or finding lookalike audiences that look like the people that are signing up and using your service today. And then finally, that last step, right, taking that single view of the customer and being able to push it into all of the other systems that require customer information, from CRM to email marketing to ad serving any number of other systems, including CMS for personalization on the website. So really being able to provide that kind of strong set of capabilities across multiple touch points and channels as you move downstream from your customer identity system. So a real strong parallel here with the market trends that we see in the market and with what Forrester is saying in the report. Now, Forrester has a group called the Data Global Business and Technographics Group, which did a security survey, and they had some really interesting findings in the report as well in terms of CIAM platforms really being able to connect the data, the insights, and security together to really serve customers better. And you can see some interesting stats here in terms of how these security professionals are planning on adopting CIAM. You can see a large group, 61%, have already begun implementing or are expanding their customer identity and access management platform today. So they've already taken a first step and they're looking at improving. And then we can see another 20% are planning to implement a customer identity and access management solution within the next 12 months. So again, that comprises almost 81% of the industry are doing some sort of work on the customer front. So this is certainly front and center for a number of IT buyers today. And then in terms of prioritizing customer security as a goal, 71% of those planning to do projects really look at customer identity as being foundational to providing that kind of secure way of accessing information. So again, not only does customer identity and access management help with a number of the key trends, but also we're seeing a huge surge in terms of demand and interest from the professionals that are implementing. So now, the highlight of any WAVE report really is the WAVE graphic. So if you think about those trends that I spoke about, those really form the criteria by which Forrester was evaluating these various vendors. And if we look at now the actual WAVE graphic itself, we can see a pretty healthy marketplace here. Forrester evaluated over 8 vendors. Each vendor had to meet a strict set of inclusion criteria in terms of being included in the WAVE overall, in terms of active implementations, being top of mind with Forrester in terms of inquiries and questions, having live customers that would be referenceable and providing those references. And inside the report, you'll see a full set of inclusion criteria that are included. So all the vendors in this report have had to meet a pretty high bar in terms of their activity in the customer identity and access management space to be included. Of course, the wave is broken into kind of these four categories of challengers, contenders, strong performers, and leaders, and you can see there are only two vendors in the leader category, and Gigya was very happy to be named a leader in this space and receive the highest scores on both current offering as well as strategy. So, a really solid foundation for us to build on. You can see a number of vendors in that strong performers category. And then being a healthy market, you can see a number of relatively new entrants or nascent vendors kind of in that contenders category, really challenging and moving into the space. So I think, it's a sign of a really healthy and strong market to have a strong set of competitors out there, and really exciting to kind of have Forrester do this evaluation. Now, what went into each category? Let's talk a little bit now about the criteria that really kind of determine the placement of each dot. One thing I really like about the Forrester Wave versus, say, a Gartner Magic Quadrant is Forrester is actually very transparent in terms of the criteria, the weightings, and the scores the vendors receive. So what you can see here is this is the current offering evaluation. And you can see here the, I'll call it a dozen or so categories that Forrester, evaluated. And, as I look at this, obviously I've I'll call it greened out as opposed to grayed out. I've greened out the other vendors' scores in this particular case. However, if you go to gigya.com/wave, you can download the full report and see each vendor's score. Now, the interesting thing is as you look at the weightings here, obviously social registration and login is very highly weighted, as is platform security and user authentication. So those are kind of key considerations. Customer data management is equally highly weighted, as well as that administration. As I mentioned, being able to go across brands, across channels, across geographies, and making sure you can provide a platform that really, kind of meets all of those challenges. And those are the kind of, I'll call it the four most highly weighted categories. And on the next slide here, you can really see the points where I put the arrow. This is where Gigya actually has the highest score in any of these categories of any vendor out there. So again, if we look across some of those higher areas, the platform security and administration, the administration category, customer data management, which is crucial to getting up and running on your platform. Again, Gigya provides the best of breed, best in class capabilities across each one of those categories. Now, changing gears a little bit here, and the next one talks about strategy and market presence. So market presence was the size of the dot on that Forrester Wave graphic, and the strategy really is what determined the vertical placement on the graphic there. So you can see things like customer identity and access management, vision, execution, the partner ecosystem, pricing, and customer satisfaction as determined by reference checks really determined that vertical placement on the graphic. And again, you can see Gigya received the highest scores across a number of these categories, including our execution, partner ecosystem, customer satisfaction, and then the sales service and technological support, along with just our size, geographic, and vertical support. So some really outstanding scores here. And I think this is really strongly reflected in the Gigya write-up as well. So, we've been in this market since 2010 and have literally the largest market presence based on revenues, direct customer installed base, and partner ecosystem than any of the other vendors included in the wave. So something that we're quite proud of, and something that Forrester has given us top scores with. Obviously, Gigya is available as a multi-tenant public cloud SaaS offering with data centers in all of those key geographies: Europe, North America, Australia, Russia, China, where those data localization requirements really are critical for meeting local regulations and requirements. And really, we're excited as well, not only about our current offering, but about the roadmap. Everything from being able to handle what we call global customers that maybe need to look at, you know, kind of maybe travel from one geography or to another and need a global view, that cross-network registration analytics to improve conversions, passwordless authentication access across multiple sites through single sign-on, and then really that kind of client-facing notice, consent, and self-service being critical to the platform. So it's something that that we're really very excited about in terms of Forrester's overall write-up about Gigya. Now, if you want to see the write-ups for all the vendors included in the report, please take a moment. You can see we've got the full report available on gigya.com/wave. You can go download the full report and gain insights from all of the different vendors and see Forrester's full write-up on the overall market. So really exciting report for anybody that's doing an evaluation right now of customer identity and access management solutions. I would say that is like the must-read report for the entire industry at the moment. Now, if we kind of think about Gigya as a player, I just wanted to recap a couple of key stats, right? Really, Gigya's platform is a system for turning those unknown site users into known loyal customers, right, through that registration and login process. We're managing this for over 700 customers today, storing 1.3 billion identities, 4.8 billion devices, and handling well over 15 billion API calls per month at the moment. So a really strong offering and a proven track record of success across multiple industries. I mentioned those 700 customers, really spanning everything from media and entertainment, kind of on the consumer side, to strong healthcare presence for more highly regulated industries, and everything in between. For example, for Auth0, we're actually storing over 60 million identities today on their behalf, and we've got some other customers that are trending more towards the 100 million entities for that, identities for that single instance. So regardless of your industry, regardless of your size and scale, Gigya can really handle, manage, and scale with you as a customer. And the best part is, we look at this as a full life cycle. So everything from obviously working with you in terms of your selection process, but also very early on with our services team, taking some of the learnings from those 700 plus customers, and we've built a whole implementation methodology that allows you to start fast and stay fast in terms of your implementation, and in many cases, get up and running with your initial project within 90 days. So something we're really proud of in terms of being able to drive from your initial selection to being in production in a very short period of time. And I think that's one of the benefits of selecting a vendor like Gigya with that software as a service perspective. So in conclusion, really, the drive and the growth in this market is really being driven by that customer identity imperative across customer experience, privacy and compliance, and security. And really, this is what's driving a lot of the activity in the marketplace, mostly from you, our customers and partners, in terms of the work that you're all doing right now, but also in terms of the analysts kind of taking that feedback, that market presence, and what they're seeing, and publishing all of these various reports on the market. And like I said, for us, the big one and the one that we're kind of excited to see out in the market and seeing a lot of interest in is that Forrester Wave report. So I was really happy to take a few minutes, give you a bit more of a personal walk through that report, and really kind of dive into that very recent publishing. As I mentioned, you can go download that report from gigya.com/wave, and all of the reports, the Gartner Critical Capabilities, the Kuppinger-Cole Leadership Compass, and that Forrester Wave are all available on gigya.com for download to help you with your selection process and get a strong bird's eye view of the customer identity and access management market. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your time on the call this morning and kind of getting that overview of the customer identity market, the major trends and areas where customer identity can help, and spending a little bit of time going through and understanding that most recent Forrester Wave report that goes through the overall market overview. So with that, I will turn it back over to Caitlin for our question and answer session.
All right. Thank you, Jason. Yes, we will be taking some questions now. So again, if you have any, please type them into the QA section on your console. We have some rolling in right now. So here's the first one. Can you comment on B2B versus B2C usage of Gigya?
Great. No, really, really good question. So Gigya, you know, our entire heritage and kind of where we've come from is really focused on that B2C use case, so really kind of business to consumer. However, we are seeing a strong surge in terms of B2B in the context of partners and managing identities on behalf of those that need access to partner systems. So again, external identity. Being able to manage that at the company level. One area where we don't directly support right now is more traditional, I'll call it employee-based or internal IAM, where really the focus is on employee lifecycle management from hire to retire, managing access to various systems, and then deprovisioning those users and then deprovisioning them across the employee lifecycle. That is an area where we feel like there's a strong set of tools. It's fairly commoditized in terms of the capabilities that are there. And really our kind of sole focus is really on that B2C use case and B2B partner, but always focusing on external customer identities versus internal employee identities.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jason. And the second question, what's Gigya's stand towards the new European Union GDPR regulation on data privacy?
No, it's a great question. I think, as I mentioned, I think the rationale and the demand for GDPR comes from a very good place, right? It's really putting consumers back in control of their data. I think for too long, companies have kind of considered themselves the first party and put a bunch of legalese in front of the customer to kind of cover their butts, so to speak. Whereas GDPR really is meant to put the consumer back in control of their data, allow them to choose what to share when, how that data is used, be able to view what data that company has, download that data, edit, change, and even in some cases delete that information. So, you know, our stance on GDPR is I think the regulation and where it's coming from makes a lot of sense to empower consumers. But it really does require for, I think, almost all organizations kind of a rethinking of that customer relationship, right? If you're empowering the customer with self-service control of their data, obviously you need a whole new set of capabilities inside your customer experience to allow them to view their profile, make those changes, download, edit, update, and to be able to do that across all channels, right, with that single consistent view of the customer. So our stance is, you know, we think it's a step in the right direction in terms of empowering consumers. We feel like there is a strong need for companies to kind of evaluate how they're serving and sharing information back with customers, how they're managing consent, and then really kind of make sure they're taking a pragmatic approach to implementing that in a transparent way, both for the consumer as well as for the EU Commission that will be doing audits and checking and making sure companies are kind of tracking those starting at the end of May in 2018. So steps need to be taken now. I think companies really do need to start that planning process because it really is a cross-functional effort between digital teams, the privacy team in your organization, probably your data protection officer, which is a requirement for many companies under GDPR, as well as your legal team, to make sure that you're working cross-functionally to provide a great customer experience that complies with GDPR.
All right, thank you for that, Jason. Next is, can you explain the role of Gigya / CIAM versus DMP or CRMs again in the tech attack, given that both are identity-centric?
Great. Really, really good question. So DMPs being data management platforms and customer relationship management systems, obviously being kind of a tool for managing, you know, the sales, customer service, view of the customer. Really, the difference between a CIAM platform and DMP and CRM really is that the first order of business for a CIAM solution is that registration and sign-up workflow, right? Really streamlining and reducing friction in that. So I think of it, CIAM is very much an operational system that's doing that first-party data capture, right? And doing that across brands, across channels, across geographies, right? So really making sure you've got a consistent way to increase your conversion rates and kind of quote-unquote bring those customers into the system. From there, DMP tends to deal in kind of more anonymized data or matching kind of current customer records, so you can kind of build up a third-party view of those customers and do more audience-based marketing. So again, CIAM tends to deal in first-party consent-based driven data. DMP tends to deal in more third-party, audience-level data. So there's a big difference in terms of the level of information and the way a DMP will use that anonymous data to push information or ads or collect information about somebody in a more anonymous cookie way versus the direct first-party consent gained through the CIAM solution. And then finally, for CRM, again, CRM tends to be a little bit more, I'll call it back office, right? Customer data tends to be fed in from other systems or directly input by a customer support representative. And really, CIAM, as I mentioned, firstly, is that operational system that collects that first-party data, likely syncs that up into a CRM or a Marketo or another marketing platform, and again, make sure that those terms of service and consent options are respected across the various systems. So again, I look at CIAM as being that linchpin position of pushing customer data into a CRM system, and then potentially, depending on the interactions with that support or sales team, potentially even pulling some information back out into the CIAM platform to make sure you've got that complete view. So hopefully that kind of answers your question about the difference between CIAM, DMP, CRM, but also how those three systems tend to interact and the information that would be shared between them.
Wonderful. And next question, can you elaborate a little more on digital marketing functionality / capabilities? You mentioned being about to more intelligently retarget and identify customers' stage in the buyer's journey. Is there a list somewhere of what you integrate with? Google Analytics? Sorry, Google Analytics, AdWords, marketing automation tool, etc.
No, really, really great question. So really, Gigya out of the box provides a solution called Customer Insights. So our CI solution really allows you in an automated fashion to build up some of those demographic and segmentation views of customers. Now, most digital marketers probably have a fairly sophisticated customer segmentation or analytical tools. You mentioned Google Analytics being one, Adobe Analytics being another, so on and so forth. There's a number of different options available, as well as different marketing automation tools from Marketo to Pear.dot to Eloqua, just to name a few. And obviously, being able to push this customer identity data into those systems or into email marketing systems or into CMS systems becomes crucial. Again, you've got that one version of the truth of the customer identity and their preferences, and you really want to make sure that you're providing that consistent view. So that integration becomes crucial. And we've got something called our IDX, or Identity Exchange, which basically is a set of tools that allows you to, out of the box, have integrations into many of these different systems. And I think as a follow-up, we can send through a link to the IDX documentation, which kind of goes through not only which systems do we integrate with, but the versions of those systems we have integrations into out of the box. Now, there's, I think, somewhere around 50 of those integrations available today. And we've also, by the way, introduced something called Identity Sync. And what Identity Sync is that, think of it as, I'll use some old school technology terms here, an extract, transform, load, or an ETL tool that allows you to then take, you know what, if you have a system that Gigya doesn't have an out-of-the-box connector for, it allows you to take ETL capabilities and kind of via the API build your own connector connection into that system. So we see a strong combination of those out-of-the-box connectors along with our identity sync capability really being key to successful implementations across multiple geographies, multiple brands that might have a very heterogeneous mix of systems in place, but being allowed, being able to use one consistent identity management platform across all of those properties via those IDX connectors and the identity sync capability if a connector doesn't exist.
Thank you, Jason. And as Gigya and Janrain are the leaders in the space, what else should be considered when selecting an identity vendor that is not reflected in the Forrester report?
Wow, great question. You know, I think there's a few things. I don't think Forrester, interestingly, I think for those of you that have purchased and implemented software, I think capability of the software, like kind of that out-of-the-box functionality is very strongly represented in this report. Obviously, you know, I think the implementation methodology and partner ecosystem are equally important to having a great customer experience. Let's face it, sales cycles are maybe 90 days to 120 days, but hopefully you're going to be using the software for 3, 4, 10 years, right? So you want to make sure that post-sale experience, the methodology for implementation, and the partner support network, as well as the company's internal support, are well vetted for, by you as part of that process. Because, like I said, after the sales cycle is done, after you've purchased the software, really getting up and running, having that system implemented, and having a great experience, really, in many ways, outweighs some of the other considerations. And I would say that is something that for anybody evaluating software, I would highly recommend you look at and think through, not just that kind of during the sales cycle experience, but really what does that post-sale cycle experience look like? Because that's the one you and your team are going to live with for much longer. And again, it's always interesting. I think these evaluation reports do a very good job of comparing feature function across vendors, but it's much harder to quantify that total customer relationship and customer experience. And that's somewhere where I feel like between our professional services team and our support team, Gigya really differentiates and stands out from the rest.
All right, thank you. And I think that's all of the questions that we have for today. Thank you all for all the wonderful questions that you sent in. Those were amazing. And thank you, Jason, for answering those and for the presentation. And if your questions were not answered today, we will be sending you a direct mail, so just be looking out for that. And this webinar will be recorded and sent out as well. Thank you very much for your time today. Have a great day.
Great, thank you.